We have a serious deficit in our community in terms of understanding how to properly engage the public and how to properly engage the broader community. We have a serious deficiency, even in terms of understanding what the Muslims call da'wah, the propagation of Islam, sharing Islam with people. We don't have a proper understanding of that. It's not something that is studied properly anymore, generally speaking. It's not something that is adequately understood and transmitted as it was historically in the Muslim community. And so when the emphasis is not on proper, good, beautiful sharing of Islam, then why would you need a space that's semi-sacred? Who cares? When people feel like to properly practice their own spiritual tradition, they have to hide away in some secluded space that cuts them off from the rest of the world, yeah, naturally, I don't want nuance. I want to be able to hide and do my religion in a way that's kind of cut off from the rest of the world. And that's problematic in terms of how you understand the example of the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he's described by some of his companions as always smiling. One of them said, I never saw the face of the Prophet except that he was smiling. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam, peace be upon him. But he's also described as being someone who was deeply reflective and almost grief-stricken, that he was deeply introspective. What the commentators say is that when he was alone, he was introspective, that he was meditative, that he had a sense of, there was a deep sobriety and seriousness. And when he was with his companions, he was smiling, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the idea that somehow the only permissible modality for a Muslim is the ostensibly religious, ostensibly sacred one. And it can create a type of social schizophrenia where a person literally has two distinctly different personalities and modalities, whether they're being social or supposedly being sacred. And that's very, very problematic. It doesn't mean that there's not going to be nuance. As we talked about, the Prophet was sober and reflective when he was alone, but he was engaging and accessible when he was with his companions. It's not to say that there's not going to be nuance, but there's two distinctly, almost, you know, diametrically opposite ways of being. And I think for many people, particularly young people in our community, it's a big problem. One of the things that was given specifically to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is that God made the entire earth a place of prayer for him. So then this kind of makes one think about the idea that, like, okay, there are indeed specific places that are called masjids, that are mosques, they're places of prayer. And they have a specific legal ruling within the Islamic tradition. There are certain things that are permissible to do there, and there are certain things that are not permissible to do there. There are certain things that are encouraged and meritorious to do in a mosque, and there are certain things that are reprehensible or frowned upon or better to be left, etc. But it's primarily intended to be a place of worship, primarily intended to be a place of devotion. But it's not the only place in the world for that to happen. And this is not to take anything away to those places that are specifically dedicated to be mosques, but it's to say that, well, if the whole earth is a mosque, then I should actually be, ideally, I should be in a sacred modality wherever I am. And this is why the Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, says, اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتَ. Be mindful of God wherever you may be, wherever you may be. So there shouldn't really be an on and off switch to my sacred modality. Ideally, I should be someone who maintains at my core a sense of presence and a sense of appreciation for sacredness wherever I may be. And again, whether that's on campus or whether that's at work or wherever that may be. So then when I'm just chilling, or if I'm just hanging out, if I'm just relaxing, if I'm just socializing, do I necessarily have to hide the sacred me? Do I have to subdue and repress the sacred me? Do I have to somehow go into a modality that kind of contradicts what should be at my core, which is a state of God consciousness and a state of desire to become someone who is enlightened? And our answer to that would be no, that you, when you're hanging socially, your sacred and your social modality, they should be reconcilable. You should have an ability to be someone who's completely, totally socially relevant, and ideally someone who's socially exemplary, someone who's socially excellent, that you excel socially. But at this, at doing, while that's happening, you maintain a heart full of Allah. You maintain a heart full of remembrance of God and consciousness. So I think as much as we need to create safe sacred spaces or safe semi-sacred spaces in our community, we also need to create safe social spaces. Spaces where we can be, it can be as hip, it can be as cool, it can be as relevant, it can be as whatever word you want to use. It can be up to par socially and be completely void of anything impermissible, completely void of anything predatory, completely void of anything poisonous to our souls. Is that something that's possible? We believe it's possible because we've seen it, we've done it, we're doing it. And God willing, we'll continue to nourish those kind of spaces in the community. I love going to mosques, and I love praying in mosques, and I prayed in mosques throughout the world. But I don't have a mosque locally that meets my personal, spiritual, social, and religious needs in the way that Tetlif does. And that's not to say that Tetlif is somehow better than others. It's just to each his own. This is what works for people like me. And what's a person like me? It's a person who's neither this nor that. I'm mixed, I'm black and I'm white. I'm Muslim, but I spent 19 years of my life as a non-Muslim. So when you're not this nor that, you need a space that's neither this nor that. It's not totally sacred, nor is it totally mundane. And it's not about, you know, it's not the same as feeding the homeless. And it's not the same as creating shelters for abused women. And it's not the same as educating the children. And it's not the same, it doesn't have the same sense of urgency as political activism. It doesn't have the same sense of urgency because ostensibly, it's not as urgent. But this is about looking at what is our community going to look like 10, 15, 20, 30, or 100 years from now? That's what it's about. It's about normalization. It's about creating spaces that allow for the core to be normal and the normal to be core.